جب ہوا عرفان تو غم آرام جان بنتا گیا سوز جانا دل میں سوزے دیگراں بنتا گیا میں اکیلا ہی چلا تھا جانب منزل مگر لوگ ساتھ آتے گئے کارواں بنتا گیا Ladies and gentlemen, when the foundation stone of MAO College was being laid down, Sir Syed Ahmed said, "This small plant will one day turn into a mighty tree whose branches will spread all over the world." In 1920, the MAO College became Aligarh Muslim University, and Sir Syed is remembered as the founder of the university. AMU has its campus at Aligarh. It is one of the most important centers of education in India. But it is also a symbol of a movement whose geographical boundaries are limitless. Sir Syed is also remembered as the founder of that movement, the Aligarh movement. That Aligarh movement is the topic of discussion this evening. And for those who came late, on the panel we have three renowned historians. We have Professor Francis Robinson from Oxford, author of many books. Professor Robinson has served as president of the Royal Asiatic Society, and he was awarded CB in 2006 for his services to higher education and for his research into the history of Islam. Next to him, we have Professor David Lelyveld, an internationally renowned historian based in New York and a figure well known to Aligarhians for his book, Aligarh's First Generation. He has written extensively on Aligarh and on Urdu culture. Next to him is Padam Shri Professor Mushirul Hasan, an alumnus of Aligarh Muslim University, who has also written extensively on Islam in South Asia. He has served as Vice Chancellor of Jamia Millia University at Delhi and as a Director General of the National Archives of India. He was awarded the Padam Shri by the Government of India in 2007. The first question must go to the alumnus of Aligarh Muslim University. We have to understand before we talk any further what the Aligarh movement actually was and what does it mean. Professor Mushirul Hasan.
Well, it means different things to different people actually. It means an educational movement which is inspired by the concept of education, ilm, and the good things that it would lead to for the Muslim community. It is seen also as in the case of the Raja Ram Mohan Roy, the Brahmo Samaj movement is seen as a Muslim renaissance of sorts, because it is not just the setting up of the college, and this is my little contribution to the answer to answer your question. It's not just that, but it means it meant a huge numbers of questions being raised about identity issues, about communitarian matters, about the language, and I think it is in that those areas where the role of people like Nazir Ahmed and Shibli and many others, I don't want to drop too many names, becomes very important, because these are exactly the issues that were being raised. In the realm of language and literature, of course, I think Aligarh's contribution is first and foremost. Unfortunately, that is not an aspect which is talked about, because very few scholars in India, I don't know about Pakistan, even know the Urdu script, and very few have the patience to go through the vast array of sources that are available. But I think that is one area Sir Syed himself set a style in Urdu writing, which is quite remarkable, which was unfortunately, if I may add a footnote, changed by Azad, and that was a retrogressive step in my view. But Sir Syed certainly set a norm. Then I think we must not forget a number of sympathizers of the Aligarh movement. I mean, Hali is a very good example, who had nothing to do with the university, but he represented or embodied, and I'm talking about the excellence in literary style, and the Muqaddama itself is a contribution which would not have been possible by anybody who was not inspired by the Aligarh movement. I mean, I stand corrected. So these are some of the ideas of social reforms, for example, idea of interpretation of the Quran. Sir Syed did it, Nazir Ahmed did it, many others did it at other levels. And those who were inspired by Sir Syed and the Aligarh movement, say, after his death in 1898, followed this up. And to answer the question that was asked in the earlier session, that today it's the Sir Syed's unfinished agenda, you know, whether what sort of liberal and rational ideas must be promoted and how and what are the mechanisms. These are questions which Sir Syed had asked. Sadly, they are not being asked today for a variety of reasons, for which you will have to invite me for another lecture, not tonight.
Now, Professor Lelyveld, sorry, am I?
No, I finished.
Professor Lelyveld, do you have anything to add on that, please?
Well, I will add that one, as I mentioned before, Syed Ahmed created a set of institutions, a stage in which all of these discussions can take place. He is one of the pioneers of print in Urdu, and from his very earliest years. And he had many enterprises which continued through life of creating books, journals, newspapers, and so on. He was a creator of organizations, of voluntary associations, local, and then he developed this concept, starting with the movement to create the MAO College, of an organization for the Muslims of India. Now, it may be the case that his vision of who the Muslims of India was were confined to his friends or to the members of, as Professor Robinson says, of the Shreve class, and that's actually what your colleague at Oxford, Faisal Javji, says in his new book. But I actually think that's not quite true. I think he thought, in a rather aristocratic sense, of an elite as leaders of the society. That's true, as did many people in many parts of the world in the 19th century, and it's not unknown today either. But he spoke again and again for the Muslims of India. And he often spoke about, in his speeches at least, if he didn't make connections, to Muslims of South India or Muslims of Bengal. When he went to Bombay, he was very interested in the Muslims of Bombay. And he went to a mosque and noticed that they pray in the mosque he went to, they pray in a different way. And he said, there's nothing wrong with that. And so on. He had this widespread notion. Then, as you say, his role in the creation of Urdu as what he thought would be a national language for all of India. And he, in his last article that he wrote, just before, a week before he died, he said, who cares about the script? Write it in Roman characters and get on with it. It should be a practical decision, and it shouldn't be a matter of religious prejudice. That's what he said. He wasn't the only one who said that, but it's never succeeded, and I don't know that it would have been a good idea, but nonetheless, he was not attached to the script. He wanted to create a national language for India. Now, he did believe that the whole history of India included the heritage of the Muslims of India, and the Mughals of India, and all of that, but that was part of Indian history. He also believed, and it's hard to imagine it now, in the British Empire. And we have to face up to that. He was a believer that ultimately the British Empire could grow into a universal, if not universal, at least a tolerant enterprise, which would make all the subjects of the Queen, as in his language, full participants in that society. And he was concerned that Muslims and his Hindu friends, and by the way, all through his life, he had close Hindu friends. It didn't stop in the 1870s. He had close Hindu friends that were participants in all his projects. So I think that's part of what the Aligarh movement means. It means the creation of modern institutions, of modern language uses, of publication, and so on, for the Muslims of India as part of a larger society, which is India as a whole, and in his day, the British Empire.
Thank you. Mr. Robinson.
Well, they've said so much, haven't they? What more could I add? I will differ slightly from David there, in that I think if we're talking about the Aligarh movement, we do, first of all, have to think of it as something which has at least two stages. The first stage, that of the 1860s, which I told you about, where Syed Ahmed is very much working for the Sharif classes of northern India. All of them. All of them. And he's concerned, primarily, that they should be able to adapt their forms of behavior so that they could operate effectively in the new dispensation created by the British. That means new learning, as Mushir has told us. It needs adopting some of the old, very floral forms of Persianate language and adopting much more direct forms of speech. It means learning new ways of behaving. It means learning new sports, like cricket. I'm sure some of you played on the Willingdon ground at Aligarh.
Yes.
It means learning, if you like, the adab, not just of the Sharif classes, but also of the British ruler, which society is very determined that they should learn, so that they can operate effectively in this new world. So, let's say, first of all, that this is something directed to the Sharif classes overall, which comes subsequently to have a stronger Muslim focus. And increasingly, Syed becomes concerned to make sure that his Muslims can deal with the challenges of modernity, as it was seen in the last 30 years of the 19th century. So that's what I see the Aligarh movement to be. Actions by a man of great intellect, but also great courage. One should never forget his courage and his leadership capacity to enable, first of all, his class, and then an element in his class, to be able to operate effectively in the new world in which they found themselves.
Thank you very much, Professor. I think my next question also must start from you because of the lot of work that you have done on separatism. This movement, was it really needed at that time? And was it about separatism or was it actually about modernism?
Well, first of all, I'd say it wasn't about separatism, although it may subsequently have had to develop a separatist dimension. One has to understand what's taking place in the last 40 years of British rule in the 19th century in northern India. The rules of power are being changed. So becoming a government servant is regarded as one of the big steps you need to make if you're going to become a powerful person. That's what the old Mughal classes used to do. But now, in order to become one of those people, you could no longer, as Sir Syed did before the mutiny, become a sort of an assistant in a kachari, an umedwa. You actually had to begin passing exams. And those exams were set by the British. And they required certain forms of knowledge. So the rules of the game in getting into the administration have changed. That's one reason why the Aligarh movement is necessary. The second is that, of course, another rule of power, which is going to become more obvious later on, is the slow development, it happens with the 1872 Municipalities Act, elections are being introduced into government, first at the local level, and then increasingly in the 1890s, and then with the 1909 Morley Minto reforms, increasingly at a provincial level. And so Muslims are going to have to acquire the skills to be able to operate successfully in this new dispensation. Arguably, public speaking and public writing are amongst the foremost of the skills required. And it was amongst the skills, that the Aligarh movement and Aligarh College in particular encouraged people to learn. It wasn't by mistake that former presidents of the Cambridge Union became teachers at Aligarh College. Those were the sorts of people who could debate, people who could win people with words. Those were the people that Sir Syed wanted teaching his students at Aligarh. So there are many other reasons why the movement is necessary. But one is the British have changed the rules of the game, so the old Sharif classes have to learn new tricks in order to succeed.
Thank you very much. Very enlightening. Professor Lelyveld, your views on whether the movement was about separatism or was it about modernism or was it about a bit of both?
I think separatism is too negative a word, at least in speaking of the late 19th century. It is a positive movement. And in that sense, it is about, you can use the word modernism, and they did. They used Jadid and so on. Those were words that were... the idea of progress, all of that language that we associate with the Victorian era is carried over and translated, or sometimes not translated, just using the English words into Urdu at the time. He wanted to create a new culture rooted in the past, but open to new adaptations. And here I would draw, if I can steal your thunder a little bit, on what you said about adab and akhlaq and so on. These are the new meanings of the concept of being sharif, of sharafat. It's not descent, it's manner. So that, in fact, a great effort is to made to bring new Muslims into Aligarh, in Sir Syed's time, from Punjab, where they don't speak good Urdu, excuse me, and and so Syed makes these tours, and they bring large numbers of students, and they're competing with government college and the Oriental College and so on in Lahore, to create a wider and wider realm in which people will share the similar forms of discourse and, yes, similar forms of behavior, manner. Think of dress. Is the gentleman still here who is wearing the Sherwani and the Aligarh cut pajama? I think
just
he
left.
That was modern. That was a new thing that was in at the time. And it spread all over. Muhammad Iqbal wore it. People in Bombay wore it. This was part of creating a new sense of the modern Muslim. And many things went with that to reform the society. And it actually, by the way, included Hindus. There are lots of Hindus. Even when I first went to India in the early 1960s, and I went to Hyderabad, I met all these Hindus wearing sherwanis and Aligarh cut pajamas.
The president of India wears that.
And of course, Nehru was completely a Sharif Admi. He was from the same kind of tradition and culture. That was something that he wanted to spread. Now, there were other styles and ideologies and ways of life that were on offer at the time, and they were competing with that. But certainly that was the notion. And Syed Ahmed Khan writes about everything. He writes about table manners, and he writes about wearing shoes.
Cricket?
He doesn't write about cricket. I don't know. By the way, in my Aligarh book, I write about cricket, mm-hmm. and there's a footnote in it in which I confess that I've never figured that out, how cricket works and so on. And one of the people who's a professor at SOAS pointed out in his review that it's a good book, but he gets cricket completely wrong.
Professor Mushirul,
well, nothing much to add to what has already been said, but I think the idea of the political underpinnings of the expression separatism had not yet developed during Sir Syed's lifetime. I think it develops after the Muslim League is established in December 1906, so maybe perhaps after the Moral-Minter reforms were with separate electorates being introduced in the Act of 1909. So I think it's a futile kind of exercise to look for the roots of separatism in Sir Syed's thinking. And we must not forget that there are others in Indian society who were probably as vociferous in condemning the Congress as Sir Syed was, whether it is Phule in Maharashtra or the landowning class in general, and many other social groups had not come to terms with the Congress because they thought that their interests would be jettisoned by the kinds of demands that... But I would say that probably the kind of vision that Sir Syed had, he didn't get a sense of what the Congress movement was all about. And I think he was ill-advised or perhaps influenced by Theodore Beck. I mean, this is my... I've argued this in a book based on the Theodore Beck papers here at the British Library, which suggests that he was being egged on by Theodore Beck to do this and to do that. And at one stage he said, I forget the exact expression in Urdu, which Theodore Beck has written to his mother. He says that, "Bahut ho gaya, main thak chuka hoon." Ye khel khelte khelte main thak chuka hoon. So it was, I think, basically Beck's doing, otherwise he, having understood the 1857 revolt, having written the kind of text that he did, Asbab-e Baghawat-e Hind, and the general sensitivity that he had, for example, on the question of whether Indian Muslims should support the Khilafat or not. I mean, his stand on Turkey is a very very forward-looking stand in many respects, where there is no place for religion. Getting back to the earlier point, he simply thinks that this is not a great idea because you Muslims would alienate the British as they did in 1857. The same logic which was behind his opposition to the Indian National Congress. So I would suggest that that it is a modernist movement, essentially a liberal movement which is cast in a liberal framework, but that it had its shortcomings. And the most important shortcoming that developed was that some of Sir Syed's close followers, as I was pointing out, had developed very serious reservations about Sir Syed's own views and the direction that the movement was going to take. You see, this is something which is probably not as widely researched, the questioning that was done in later years, and especially when Muhammad Ali and others became quote-unquote radical, there was this tremendous reaction against the politics of subservience. And the fact that Francis, of course, discussed it very well in his book, but there was a very strong reaction. Or mujhe yaad nahi Muhammad Ali ka sher ka sikhaya tumne hashr kya wagaira wagaira. Lot of people thought, what is this rubbish? Yes. You know.
That's a very interesting topic, and we'll of course sometime have a good discussion about it in another meeting. But I think we will move on. Thank you very much, Professor. We'll move on to Professor Lelyveld again. Now, you gave an excellent lecture today about Sir Syed's religion. And you said, you said that it was something personal to him. He regarded as religion as something personal. That is obvious from your lecture, and I think everybody would agree with that. But he did do a lot of work on religion. He wrote a commentary, as you said, on Quran. He also wrote a commentary on the Bible. At that time, especially among Muslims, you know, this was something very unusual. Also, the changes in the thinking of theologians that has come in the Europe now, you know, the way the religious text is interpreted now in Europe, for example, is very different from the way the classical Muslim theologians are interpreting their religious text. Now, what I want to ask is whether Sir Syed Ahmad Khan was trying to do what some of the modern theologians in the West are doing now at that time by reinterpreting his religion and making it relevant to the circumstances, to the times, and also trying to seek common ground between Christianity, Hinduism, Islam, and also with science, because he actually in his tafsir he uses the word, writes in Urdu, but he uses the word that the work of God cannot be the word of God cannot be different from the work of God. So was he trying to bring out a new interpretation, something that is probably needed 100 years before, 196 years before?
Well, this is what you've always wanted me to talk about, and I have to say, as I said before, that theology is not my subject. I'm not very good at it. But I would say this. I have read these texts and dutifully, and he changes over time. for one thing. If you read that commentary on the Bible, he believes a lot of things that he would not have believed later on in life. He dates Noah, the flood of Noah on the assumption that the world was created 5,000 years ago. He believes a lot of things that he would later on come to know is not consistent with modern science, and he moves more toward a understanding in the tafsir of religious ideas as metaphorical, symbolic, aimed at creating a certain kind of ethical position, and aimed at making people understand that they are part of a larger cosmic order. And that you didn't really have to believe in the details of heaven and hell and Jibril coming to Muhammad and all of that. That's poetry, he didn't do. Although he was aware that it could be done, he didn't do the kind of historical criticism people were starting to make of the Bible, and he did not accept the notion which had risen in Germany in the 19th century, that the Quran was a man-made thing, that it was written by different authors at different times, and that you could study the text and realize that this was taken from this source and this was taken from that source. He accepted that the Quran was the word of God, and had come through the lifetime of the Prophet Muhammad, and been revealed to the Prophet Muhammad. He didn't question that, and those people who have questioned that are much more radical than Sir Syed ever was.
In fact, in the tafsir, he first establishes the 15 principles on which he will be writing the tafsir, and as you say, that this is the first one, that the Quran is the word of God. Professor Robinson, your views.
Just one thing, which is a direct answer to the question you put to David, and that is that Sir Syed was, in the late 1850s, and probably continued to do so afterwards, reading modern biblical criticism. Okay? So he is obviously reading that. To what extent he takes it on board is another matter, but he's reading it. Secondly, I would say that I think his great tafsir, and what comes out of his great tafsir, which is really the principles of Islamic modernism, is a considerable achievement, and one which I suspect some Muslims will continue to build on for many years to come. Although it has, its techniques also have their critics. It's too reliant on a Western vision of science, inverted commas. But a third thing that I think we ought to bring up here, because it's one point at which Syed Ahmed is particularly courageous. Some of you will know that Sir William Muir was Lieutenant Governor of the Northwestern Provinces and Awad in the 1860s, and he had produced in 1861 a four-volume Life of the Prophet, a very considerable work of Oriental scholarship, but also badly infused with evangelical Christian positions. So he ends up saying, although the Prophet did many, many good things, nevertheless, his existence was one of the great barriers to civilization in this world. Syed Ahmed, who is a personal friend of Muir, is deeply enraged by this. And of course, part of the reason for his visit to England is actually to do the research which enables him to answer the points that Muir has made. And this I mean, this, to my mind, is this is all part and parcel of the man. But this man is speaking up in a very powerful way against one of the most distinguished British administrators of India at the time. So I think this should always be remembered, that when he sees the prophet, if you like, his name, if you like, dragged through the dirt in some ways, Syed Ahmed stands up and says, this is wrong, and is wrong for this, 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 and this reason.
Thank you, Professor Mushirul. Yeah. Nothing to add to that, thank you. Now we come to the last question. Professor, it has to go to you, so you can't escape.
But what if I keep quiet?
You can't. On this one, you cannot. Because, as I know, there is only one, or maybe a very few people, very few old boys of Aligarh who have studied at the girls' college. And you have.
Studied at the girls' college?
Yes.
At. Okay.
And that is the question coming to you then. What did this movement, Aligarh movement, do for women?
Difficult question to answer, but in the larger context, obviously, people like Sheikh Abdullah were products of that. Again, his name is not figured, but if one were to read Gail Mino's work and other writings, clearly he was inspired by Sir Syed's ideas and his rationalism. And Sir Syed's own position on women's education, I'm afraid, is very ambivalent. In fact, on some occasions, you know, he seemed not to approve of their education. And Nazir Ahmed, who was otherwise an extremely enlightened individual, is also very ambivalent. In fact, wrote a pamphlet to this effect. It's not, Zakaullah is certainly opposed to women's education. So I think there is a problem here. As opposed to these three very distinguished people, there was a movement in Bengal around the same time among Bengali Muslims, Bengali reformers, for the empowerment of Muslim women. And that developed very strongly in the 1880s and 1890s. So I think these are facts of history, but on the other hand, I think the overall impact of the Aligarh movement was such that it triggered or generated different kinds of ideas, different ways of thinking. And I think this way of thinking, that is, women should share with men in education, also developed out of the Aligarh movement.
Professor Lelyveld.
Well, it's a very interesting subject. When Syed Ahmed went to England, he was very impressed that women could read and write. The servant women in the house would read newspapers and so on, and he wrote about that. He wrote a number of essays on women and education in which he said, in effect, the world isn't ready for it. And I think it was one of several places where he partly was motivated. He had enough problems with the general public to take on the cause of women's education would have sunk the movement, perhaps. He doesn't quite say that, but he was very much against it. Now, you have to remember, the women in Sir Syed's family were all educated. They all were literate. They knew the Quran. They knew Urdu literature. It was not, and he was very attentive. What he writes about his mother, what he writes about his daughter, who died young, his daughter-in-law. These are all people who wrote, and so he lived in a world. Now you have to also remember that there wasn't a lot of women's education in what
what Francis was referring to as the Sharif classes. For example, the Nehru family, the women in the Nehru family did not come out of Purdah until about 1910. So not in Sir Syed's lifetime. My understanding, even after the college, the women's college was established, what I understand is that the first Muslim woman to appear there out of Purdah was Irfan Habib's mother. Mm. That is Professor Muhammad Habib's wife, who was a Tayabji from Bombay. And who defied all those rules. But certainly Purdah was an accepted form of, as it still is. And that didn't mean women shouldn't be educated, but there was this keen sense of separation of men and women. And that remains, of course, a huge issue among Muslims.
Yes, I just add, my view, which in a sense of Sir Syed's position, was that let's look after the chaps first, and then we'll then we'll deal with the women. That it was a matter of priorities. I think we ought to note that Mumtaz Ali, who plays a very important part in developing the magazine Hatun and so on, is closely associated with Sir Syed towards the end of his life. That so Sir Syed's friends are working towards developing or empowering women. But I think the most important thing is that if you think of many of the striking women of, if you like, the generation of the 20s and 30s and so on, 1920s and 30s, Rashid Jahan, Ismat Chugtai, a little later, Karanta Len Heda, these are all the daughters of Aligarh men. So even if Sir Syed didn't drive it forward, within the framework of the movement, and with those who were educated in Aligarh, the process of empowerment took place.
Thank you very much, Professor. You said what we needed. Thank you. Okay, now the last round is about a message from each of you intellectuals to the Aligarh community about Sir Syed or the Aligarh movement, starting with Professor Mushirul.
Well, my message is what I said in my speech. For God's sake, write a decent book on the Aligarh movement.
Okay. Professor Lelyveld.
I don't know that I have a message. I'm trying to think. Sir Syed, what fascinates about Sir Syed is this huge enterprise of that he set in motion, and which had so many aspects to it. And there are very few people in the history who have that kind of wide interest and influence as a historian, as a political organizer, as a social organizer, as an educator, and so on. But I will just repeat that he set the stage for future developments. He wanted to set the stage not for his own glorification, but for future developments within the community. And in many cases, as in the Women's College, it bore fruit. In many cases, it went off in different directions, from the role of Aligarh in the founding of Pakistan to the role of Aligarh in the leadership of the Communist Party of India.
Professor Robinson, please.
Yeah. Well, I'm going to treat Professor Hasan as part of the Aligarh community here, because he's been urging all of you to say, really, someone's got to start writing, doing some decent research on the Aligarh movement. Professor Hasan has been a leading historian in South Asia for several decades. Why aren't your students doing this? Would be the question.
Because they focused on Jamia.
Okay, we'll leave that there.
Jamia is an offshoot of the Aligarh movement.
It is indeed, mm-hmm. It is. But in terms Jamia of the more general message, I would say, reflecting upon Sir Syed, I would say, first of all, leadership. He was a quite extraordinary leader. And you don't find many leaders of that quality in a century, in a society. Secondly, courage. You might say courage is the natural quality of a leader, but he had immense courage, quite dauntless. And thirdly, he used his leadership qualities and his courage to renew society. And that seems to me, for the Aligarh person of today, what more important can you be doing than leading the process of renewing the society in which you move?
Thank you very much.
No, I would want to reinforce what I said. If you look at the PhD dissertations produced by the Department of History at Aligarh, which has been a premier department, there's no question about it. It's also a center for advanced study. You will be surprised to know that not a single PhD dissertation has been produced by that department. And I say this, you know, the cameras, and so people in Aligarh are going to watch it and will prevent my entry into the university. But this is a fact, and I have been saying this. How do you expect others to write your history if you yourself don't write it?
Right. Okay, Professor, your message will definitely reach Aligarh with the images. Ladies and gentlemen, I think, and you have heard the panel discussion, it should now be clear to you what the Aligarh movement was about. The movement was about education. The movement was about emancipation. The movement was about equality, and the movement was about enlightenment and reform. The movement is still alive. We are all part of it. At times, we will be ignored. At times, we will fail. But with the vision the founder of the movement has given us, we will keep pressing. We will keep telling the truth. We will keep asking the right questions. Hum parvarishe lauh qalam karte rahenge jo dil pe guzarti hai raqam karte rahenge ek arz taghaful hai so wo unko mubarak ek arz tamanna hai so hum karte rahenge. Ladies and gentlemen, for the panel.